This is the April 6th, 2016 Finance Committee meeting. Bring it to order, please turn off your phones if you will, or at least put them on silent, and we will proceed.
Present today, Chairman Hurd, Vice Chair Vigiam, Clerk Bailey, Stuart Novak, Tom Worthen, and Joan Fons.
Very good. All right, is there any, we have some citizens in the audience, is there any citizen participation? All right, there being none, then we'll proceed along. Town Administrator is not here, so we'll skip right along to, let's see, do we have anyone for the Wareham Wetlands bylaw?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Very good.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, my name is Joe Benedict.
Joe?
I'm one of the two citizen appointees to the Wetlands Committee, bylaw committee. And I'm not too sure what you have been forwarded. You should have been forwarded a report from the Wetland Bylaw Study Committee, and also a, what's called a redline version of the actual revised bylaw, our proposed revision.
We did. We were forwarded both of those.
And I'm unfamiliar with the procedure at this point, so.
All right.
I'm happy.
We'll give you a lot of latitude on this. What we'd like you to do is describe a little bit about the setup of the bylaw committee and what you set out to accomplish and what you did accomplish.
Okay, the wetlands, as detailed in the report, paragraph one, the committee was actually required or requested at the October 26, 2015 Wareham Town Meeting. The committee was to be made up of, and the town moderator can correct me on this, but it was to be made up of both citizens and members of selectmen and members of various committees.
Mm-hmm.
We did meet on a number of occasions. We took the existing bylaw and the major limitation we had was the time we had to produce a document. We obviously couldn't start from scratch, so we had to start with what we had and make some logical, which we think are logical, changes to the law to make it more readable, more user-friendly, more instructive. And that we get into in the actual report. If I can, the report isn't that long. And the third paragraph down, the recommendations we're making is moving the definitions to the beginning. It's always nice to know what the words mean at the beginning. We corrected some typographical, stylistic things, and to make the document more readable, we extended the definition of vernal pool to match the Wetland Protection Act itself. Clarified the maintenance exemption under the bylaw, added a provision under application for permits, and this was a staff suggestion, to specify individual permits on individual lots as opposed to just a group permit for a subdivision. There apparently is some issue with tracking these, and it seemed to be better to have it an individual permits for individual homes, individual lots.
Does this increase the record keeping and permit processing for someone who is making some sort of subdivision?
No.
They don't have to apply for 100 permits? Really, they used to have to apply for one?
As I understand it, and I'm relatively new.
Sure.
The existing, a one-size-fits-all permit would actually have all of the lot numbers on it anyway. This merely makes it more convenient to track in the future with individual lot numbers. Apparently, as I understand it, we all would like computers to handle everything, but apparently the computers aren't able to track conveniently and consistently restrictions on individual lots within a subdivision.
Does this increase the cost to the applicant?
No, it does not. That's one provision to the best of my knowledge, we did not make any changes to was the cost of the permit. There were no changes to the fees associated with it.
I think the concern of the board is not the actual dollars that are paid out to the board, but the actual cost of applying for the application as far as legal fees and filing fees and expenses internal to the person who's applying for the application.
No, it's my understanding that it would be basically budget neutral at that point to the applicant. It's just a convenience for tracking and also enforcement in the future, which apparently is a big deal with the Conservation Commission. Going further down, clarified the language that wetland replication, the language to mimic the requirements of the state regulation. And number seven, which was kind of one that proved more difficult than it appeared at first, we simply tried to remove the ADA sections because apparently there was some issue with saying, is this person ADA accessible or not? And we also wanted to accommodate people who generally just want to get on their own property to a resource. Mm-hmm. Currently now, they really can't. They can't have a footpath, which caused all kinds of problems. What is a footpath? What isn't a footpath? And we wrestled with the definition, and at the end of the document is the last page. If we identified there was some concern that a footpath and a pedestrian path could also include motor vehicles. That wouldn't be my reading of it, but anyway, we tried to insert language to get rid of that notion that you can't drive vehicles up and down, with the exception of perhaps an ADA type vehicle. And that again would be specified in the permitting process, that what the actual means of access would be, and the width of the path would be determined by what that access is. You obviously don't need a 5-foot path if it's a footpath, mm-hmm. Or pedestrian, whatever. You might need a 5-foot path or a 3-foot paved path if it is for ADA accessibility, like my mother's hub around getting her somewhere. We got into later on in the report, and one of the big issues which people tend to forget is regulations aren't necessarily a means of penalizing people or a means to make things tough for you. They are also intended to be guidance, particularly in the area where there are multiple answers to a given requirement. And the regulation is also, we try to make it more towards giving you guidance on what the Conservation Commission and the town would expect you to do when you have some natural resource that you want to do something in or around. And again, we do make some very, very minor suggestions in the future. We believe that the Conservation Commission should continue to look at changes to the conservation law. Our understanding of conservation, what we're conserving and how these systems work, change with time. Therefore, the regulation must change with that time as our understanding change. This is not a budget neutral item. We think the commission should be authorized to retain a consultant to assist in evaluation of new construction techniques and material utilized in resource areas. As we all know, the creosote soaked piling is no longer what people want to put in. They want to put it in, but you shouldn't. There are other methods of constructing docks or other methods of constructing pads or whatever structures you want to put that are much more environmentally friendly. There's also one area which I know is very sensitive to a lot of
people. Can I just interrupt? Who would pay for this consultant?
That's why I said it isn't a budget neutral. It would.
Does the applicant pay for that?
Not necessarily. We were talking, the applicant could, under the existing regulation.
I don't think any applicant's going to volunteer to do it. Are they required to do it?
An applicant is, and I don't believe it's commonly enforced, but under the existing bylaw, the applicant must pay for the cost of a consultant the Conservation Commission would hire after adequate notice that this is what it's going to cost you. What we're talking about is more of a consultant to come up with, you don't want to call it a laundry list, but a list of accepted practices utilizing the newer construction techniques that are out there. Pier construction, for one. There's a lot of changes in the way piers are constructed. And right now, those require some specialized engineering skills that perhaps a consultant would be better off advising the town on. I know from my personal experience, a lot of these new environmentally friendly designs don't work, and they fail relatively soon. And to me, the discussions, as I recall it, was to provide guidance in evaluating, for the commission to evaluate what would constitute a good alternative to some construction, common construction practice, if that makes sense. Hmm.
So this is similar to having Charles Raleigh review a planning board application. Is that correct? An applicant would make a presentation saying, I'm going to do X, Y, Z.
Yes.
And then you would have a consultant review it.
Correct. That would be one. The other, what we were talking about, the impetus behind the whole thing was to see if there was some, that would be one use. The other use was to see if there was
some standard grouping
of practices that could be allowed, rather than each applicant having to defend the same thing all the way along.
Is that something that a group of conservation commissions may investigate, rather than each town doing the same thing? Is that something that the Association of Conservation Commissioners may have done in the past?
I've been in the town of Wareham a little less than a year, and my limited reading of the various conservation commissions, both Cape Cod, the Massachusetts, Barnstable, and we did review towns, that there are acceptable practices that are kind of generally adopted, but I think what each town has a specific need. The piers in and around Wareham are somewhat different than something you would expect in Chatham, for example. It's just a different environment, and perhaps my guess would be the construction practices would be different in a more open environment, open body of water, as opposed to a pond or something like that. that's kind of off the cuff.
All right.
You know, personal opinion, a lot of that, but...
This is one of your recommendations for the future, then?
Yes.
All right, so we're not asked at this point, and that was not in the bylaw?
No, it's not in the bylaw.
All right. This is a ongoing process.
The third future action, there are a lot of homes and parcels. The majority of the land is located within a resource area. And they are virtually prohibited from doing anything. We're not saying that variances should be granted on every parcel for anything that wants to be done. But there ought to be several of the committee members and members of the audience, but there ought to be some method to allow variances within the buffer zone. And the committee was pretty well split on it also. I retired from a conservation agency, so I tend to be a bit more conservative in that area, because once the resource is gone, it's gone. But we felt that the commission should look into whether variances can be allowed in this area for properties that are pretty much nothing can be done on them. We're not talking about wholesale putting making a patio into a Four Season room we're not talking to that, but there ought to be some, to see if there was some way to some proportion or some minor work that could be done that could be, if there was some procedure that could be enforced, then that's pretty much the problem is enforcing it and keeping track of it. And we added at the end of that having previously legally developed, we're not talking about a continuing expansion of a violation.
But that again is not in the bylaw.
No, that's not in the bylaw. Again, this is a recommendation.
A recommendation for future study.
So
this is an ongoing process. You've come up with a revised bylaw, which you'll be presenting at town meeting.
Yes.
And you expect that in the future, other changes to the bylaw will be presented.
That's been the one in my 45 years in the environmental field. The one constant has been change. And you have to adapt to it. Or just like endangered species, you're gone. And not wholesale adaption either. There needs to be a recognition that people want to use their property. And there also needs to be an understanding that the state law quite simply says, you know, no person shall. And then carves out some very small exceptions. So it's a balancing act. It's a balancing act between conservation and what people want to do. And I know it's difficult, but it hasn't. It's no different here than anywhere. That it is a balancing act, and people are, some development is going to have to happen, but it needs to be considerate of what the resource is and how it's being protected. We see it. One example that I would say, I hadn't been on the Cape in a number of years. My parents had moved often. And I visited some of the beaches. And the boardwalks that I used to be able to go to the beach aren't there anymore, and they're very narrow. Well, that's an example of allowing people access to a resource and also protecting the resource. So what we're talking about is there is going to be development. People are going to come in. They're going to want to develop them. and it needs to be a mechanism going forward that is fair and can be administered fairly to everyone. That's why the language we chose is can be implemented. You know, it's good to say you can allow variances or same as a building code. You know, there simply are non-conforming uses and non-conforming structures. And do you allow them to continue? That's up to the town.
Then what is being recommended? Do you feel that it strikes at least a start for towards a balance to what the private ownership wants to do and versus conservation of that resource?
I think it recognizes there is a competing, those are competing interests, and it attempts to address it positively, say we are going to look at it to see if it's possible. It's not adversarial. We didn't want to be adversarial about anything. We didn't want to be pushover either. But I think it strikes a balance as best it can be done in such a relatively short period of time.
Under current conditions, yeah.
Yes. You know, and I realize, you know, like I said, I'm relatively new to buying a home around here, too, and even though I grew up in Fall River, things have changed, and we need to change with the way the changes are going.
I have a question. In the copy that was sent to us,
yes.
The changes were highlighted in red, and all of the definitions are in red. I assume that's because they were moved, not necessarily because they were all changed. Makes it a little bit difficult to follow.
The definitions that are now up front.
Right.
They're in red with there should be on page 3 a blue.
All right, as well as within 100 feet of the mean annual boundaries of such depression.
Right, that's the definition I talked about.
And that's the new part.
That's the new part, yes.
All right.
There would be a strikeout if it had changed. And this is an insert. It unfortunately doesn't come out real well if you photocopy it. It's something that's necessary.
Right.
That's the one thing the programmers didn't learn. They thought everyone would have a color copy, and that's not necessarily the case. And the differences in the colors, here's a nice, wonderful purple here. That's just a different person coming in at a different time.
All right.
We tried to not, we didn't keep anything we changed a secret, which is why we produced the redlined copy.
No, that's fine.
You know, even though people like to see a clean copy, we felt it was better to produce the redlined copy.
It is, right? You can readily identify what you're doing. It's easier for the reader to understand.
So there aren't a lot of changes in
no.
in your revision. In fact, there are very few, really.
Yes, that's correct.
It seemed, well, and thank you for volunteering. Our expertise is helpful. That sounds like you. I think the reason this came up was to streamline the process to an answer, yes or no, and reduce the cost of outside consultants to the applicant, and there don't seem to be a lot of substantive changes in that direction. It doesn't seem like anything's different in this. They've cleaned up some language, and then again, you mentioned you didn't have a lot of time, but if we adopt this, what's to keep it going? What's to keep it feels like my neighbor, for instance, wanted to extend his deck 4 or 5 feet. He's within 75 feet of, it was 70 feet away. And he finally gave up, but the guy's been mowing there for 30 years. It's not anything protected. It's his lawn that he just wanted to cover up with 3 or 4 feet of deck. And how do we keep, get him a permit for something that's of no value to a resource zone? It's somebody's lawn. And but protect 60 feet away from that where he hasn't mowed and it's still very natural and there's clams and ducks and whatever in there.
The problem, and I agree with this part wholeheartedly, and it's quite common, I see it in my neighborhood, the 4 foot deck becomes a 4 foot paved patio. The 4 foot paved patio isn't big enough, so it becomes 6 feet. Then it becomes 8 feet with a roof. Well, you put a roof over it, let's make it a three season room or a Florida room or whatever you want to call it. And wow, gee, we got a three season room. Why not just insulate it and make it a four season room? And well, now, gee, I've got a path that I can ride my, I got a path to the water now. Gee, maybe I need a golf cart. And if I have a golf cart, I need a shed to put the golf cart in. And I need a 100-gallon storage tank for the gas I'm using. I understand what you're trying to say. But the 100-foot and the 30-foot buffer, the 30-foot no activity zone, there needs to be an end to what's allowed, or else that there's no purpose in a regulation.
Well, and that's fine, but he wasn't really told no. He just kept going through the process and going and going, and that's the what we're hearing is that the process goes on forever and ever. And then when lawyers get involved, the Conservation Commission caves and whatever gets done anyway. And it doesn't make any sense. It's costing a lot of money and slowing down positive development and not taking away any non-positive.
I would argue that it's not all positive development.
We shouldn't be talking about a particular application and whether it's positive or not, but
again, I don't know any of the specifics.
No.
Right, but my point was there's no substantive changes here. We're exactly the same spot we were with an exception for a footpath. Am I wrong?
No, I think we've taken care of some of the, apparently there's a problem with vernal pools, there's a problem with permitting. I participated a number of years ago in the county redoing their floodplain ordinance and flood control ordinance. And we took the document, it's about this big. It's not 2 inches thick. It's impossible for the average citizen to fill it out. It's impossible. But when you start down the road of allowing 4 feet, 3 feet, 2 feet, and is his 100-foot shed as bad as my 100-foot shed? People don't know why this is different than that. Then is his neighbor, the people's neighbors, who are the people who live across the resource. They don't want to see that. You know, there are individual people who will feel like they've been wronged. And, you know, I would have liked to have purchased a home right on the water, put a nice pier out. The mortgage company wouldn't insure it, but if your answer is in the space of 6 weeks or 8 weeks, or however long the committee was actually together, are you going to come up with the perfect wetlands? No.
No, but what you're presenting is what you've been able to do in a fairly short period of time. Is the recommendation going to be that the committee continue? Is it going to stop?
Right now the committee, goes away.
Is finished.
Yes. Well, we've got through June 1st, I think. There is a, the appointment ends, and I forget what date it is. But we're recommending that the Conservation Commission take it up and specifically charge them with making changes. That's where your expertise is. You know, your long-term expertise is there. And we're suggesting that perhaps they need some assistance. We have one, we have a Conservation Commission, one enforcement person, as I understand it. There's a lot of resources out here that are trying to be protected. You know, and you just think that it's going to be a process. It's not going to change tonight.
The reason this came up originally was because of the, and you did change the access to the water. You did address that issue.
I understand that was a big issue with people. Literally, the way it was written, you couldn't even walk through.
That was a very serious consideration.
Yeah. Yeah. And again, I've seen that populated with language where you need a landscape architect to design that pathway. You know, we could have, you know, that would be a very easy way to go.
All right, so, but the committee did address that issue and you did change some of the format of the bylaw.
Yes.
All right. Excuse me, Alan, you had a question or a statement?
As explained by Mr. Tidalong, who was on that committee, they kind of took away the issue that they had with the ADA compliance, the path thing, and now it's a path, we've got a creek and stuff in there. A couple words that we think we're going to change the town meeting for because a creek doesn't exist, whereas in Portland, creeks exist other parts of the country, things like that. So, but the biggest thing really is that it gives the Conservation Commission some latitude when someone's applying for something right now that just doesn't fit the rules. They have latitude now to make exceptions within reasonable, you know, form. It's a little gray, obviously, because it's the word reasonable. But it does open it up where there was no chance before. What Alice is looking for really is just not feasible at this point in time. You do have to see, you know, a new planner in who'll be working a lot of these things, so they will have a lot more access to a highly qualified person to help them along. And the other piece was that the Conservation Commission will pick up when this is over and continue to work on this particular bylaw.
Well, what pushes them to do it, though? What's their motivation?
They want to do it, that's why.
It's my understanding, from sitting with the two members of the Conservation Commission, they're somewhat frustrated also, you know, and I think, and correct, right, there is a planner coming on board, but unfortunately it's a part-time planner, and, you know, this is part of the planning process. What do you want your resource areas to look like? And to me, you can't do a change in a wetlands bylaw without changing, without taking into account what you want your town to look like when it's done.
So what we're looking at tonight is the first step in a process.
Yes.
And the particular item that you addressed was to clarify some aspects of the bylaw to provide, to avoid needing the definition of ADA disabled for access, and that plus providing some flexibility within the bylaw itself. All right. Tom?
Are you going to be on the Conservation Commission?
No, sir. Absolutely not.
Coward.
I can hear Claire. No, I am retired, and I'm newly retired. I want to stay retired. I spent 45 years arguing these things. I worked for both in the public and the private sector, about equally in those 45 years. Worked for a conservation agency. I've heard all of the arguments, and you know, you're never going to make everybody happy. That's number one.
Well, there are people out there who won't take no.
That's correct, and the people won't take yes either. And the one thing that I took away was, I think there's a feeling that this resource, these resources are being taken from people. They're right to use them. And that is not the purpose at all. I mean, this, whatever you pass as a bylaw, cannot be any less stringent than state requirement. And the state requirements start out by saying, the state law starts out by saying, no person shall, and then goes on to carve out some exceptions and allowing some local latitude. But as in the case of zoning laws, which people are very familiar with, or building laws, if everything becomes a variance, there is no law. And that's the problem you run into. The other option is to come up with a laundry list. This structure, that structure, this is, and it just goes on and on and on and on. And you end up with a 2-inch thick document that I participate in. So
we don't want that.
We don't want that. I don't want to live through that again myself either.
Very good. Thoughts?
Or does this get reviewed, or do you go vet it through the Buzzards Bay Coalition, or Audubon, or people like that? Are there?
We had thought about doing that during the process, but we looked at the calendar and we just couldn't
Didn't
do
have
it.
The time.
We just couldn't do it. I think, based on my understanding of we did discuss it and what people said, I think if it was vetted through other conservation agencies, particularly those further out on the Cape, you end up with a much stricter law. That's my feeling after talking to people.
All right.
Which isn't bad, necessarily.
No, I'm not saying it's a bad thing. And like I said, I retired from a conservation agency. But I do realize we have to live on this rock. And
Bernie?
No, I think the objectives are made. They're complicated to begin with. As you say, you have opposing points of view. They could flip at any time depending on what you're asking. So it's very difficult to reach a balance. And hopefully, though, the community has an opportunity to reach a balance with its own citizens through this effort.
And hopefully, I'm encouraged that the nasty rhetoric that predominated politics, let's say, for the past few years, particularly the agency I was at, it was really bad too, seems to be running its course. And to have a constructive dialogue is important. And I think people are finally realizing it's okay to disagree.
Definitely. Ellis?
I think we should get a full document and accept it as a full document instead of making minor incremental changes over the next 3 or 4 town meetings to get a final bylaw.
So you're saying it's an unfinished?
Well, it is. There's, and I appreciate the work and the time limitations. Maybe it's just one at a time. And we've already got a list of changes that you'd like to see. And maybe we should make a full law before we pass it.
As a finance committee, our interest is not getting sued and real estate values in town.
Limiting, I don't mind if someone says no, but they should get that no pretty quickly without having to spend a lot of money on engineers and lawyers to get there.
I agree with that 100%, yeah.
And I feel like that's kind of a nutshell. The problem was, you know, and some people won't take no and on, but, you know, this long drawn out process of extending your deck a couple feet.
Okay. Stuart?
I agree with Alex. I don't mind accepting this if there's some guarantee as part of this that this committee will continue and make these other changes.
The committee was formed.
Formed by the town meeting.
Well, I'm saying it's part of putting this forward.
Can't do that. Town meeting set a date, that's it. You have to go back, town meeting has to do it.
Has to create it all over.
I understand. But town meeting won't pick it up unless somebody suggests.
That's our recommendation.
I'm just saying it's not your purview, that's all.
Then.
I don't mean to insult you, it's just not that.
To me, unless it's violating some procedure, then it would be appropriate for the finance committee to recommend a consultant be hired and find the money. That would be appropriate if that's the course.
You feel that no progress, further progress can be made without consultants?
The.
Which is reasonable.
This is based on my experience.
Yeah.
There are a number of environmentally sensitive construction practices that can be utilized. And the simple practices and also the actual structures that are put in place. Some of these structures haven't stood the test of time yet. They haven't been around long enough. So I think to rely on individual purveyors of these things to come in and explain it to you perhaps isn't the best way to go about doing it. Perhaps hiring someone on a short-term basis that is familiar and does this, recommends these things over a variety of resources would be a better way to go. That would be my personal opinion. I put many things in the ground that was supposed to be the greatest thing since sliced bread, and it simply did not work. I've seen wetland replication that simply did not work.
I think there are two issues here. One, I think what Ellis is saying is that what you've addressed is the immediate problem that was the object of the study commission, which was access to the water and a way to do that, which is fair and avoids the lawsuits that were, I shouldn't say pending, but possible at that point. And I commend you for that. It is obviously an ongoing process. I think part of the reorganization, which is being proposed, will help address that. And as Ella said, I agree. I hope that the Conservation Commission, the Conservation Commissioner, continues the effort to refine this bylaw and to make it so that it is, shouldn't say user-friendly, that's a terrible word, but so that people can understand it and can get prompt responses on their applications.
There are ways to go about doing that, but they always come with a price.
I think what Ellis says is correct. We probably solve the short-term problem, but there are other long-term problems that still exist that you either didn't have the time or the committee did not address them. And so it's an ongoing process we have to involve, and we should monitor this to make sure Conservation Commissioner is continuing towards that goal. And if necessary, comes before town meeting and creates another commission to solve those other problems.
That was the reason for recommendation one, was that we recognized that it isn't over and it's never going to be over because things change. Our understanding of these resources changes. The value of them changes with public opinion.
Nope. Joe, thank you very much.
No problem.
I appreciate your efforts on the committee. I appreciate your expertise. And we're fortunate that we have people
Welcome
in the
to
community
the
with that expertise.
It's been an interesting year.
Well, we're pointing for the interesting decade.
Me too.
Okay.
Hope
good.
I'm around if you would.
Claire, give him six more months as a retiree. You'll want to get back to it.
We hope. All right, I would like to entertain a motion to accept the revised wetlands bylaw as presented. It does address the issue that was, that the committee was raised for. It was a compromise made at the last minute at town meeting where we had the opportunity to, or there was a petition to actually delete the entire bylaw, which would have put us back on the state. So my recommendation is that we accept this. We understand that it's a ongoing process and that we can expect additional changes in the future.
Motion to accept.
Do we have a second? All those in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Aye.
Okay, it is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 2, 1. I have 1-0. Very good. Thank you very much. All right. Guy?
Yes?
Maybe we can discuss a little bit about the water pollution control facility.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening to you.
Special spring town meeting, infiltration and structural rehabilitation, engineered plans. It's changing the language of Article 7.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. I've got your list here. If you want me to go down the list or if you want to take it out of order, you tell me how you want me to go.
Why don't you go through the list?
I'm just going to go down and then we can take it from there. And
very good.
Question and answers, how we want. So the first question you asked me was about the indirect costs. And what you were wondering is what happened to 15 and 16. So I want to give you 15 and 16, the indirect costs that were in the budget presented at town meeting. So it's an ongoing process. The indirect costs are given to us from the town administrator, and then I incorporate into the budget. We are working on, as the manager, Larry took a little piece out of it, explains that we're working on a formal agreement. And once we have the agreement, it'll be a template to follow in the future.
All right, let me just explain to people. In looking at the WPCF finances, the indirect costs were not listed in previous years. They were listed for the current year, but they were not listed for the previous year. So I ask that we be given those costs for the previous years. Thank you.
Yeah, so just one number. So that, I believe that's, unless you have any other further questions on the indirect cost article. And your question was Article 24, which is the budget itself.
Yes.
Which has been accepted by the sewer commissioners, which includes the direct and indirect costs.
Fine.
Article 3. So I think all your questions on 3, Article 4, and then your questions about where are we in Swiss speech, transferring the money, I think they all become one package. So I tried to put together a package for you.
Fine.
That'll address all of that. And so I'll give you a copy of that. And so it all starts with 314 CMR 12.4. And so what we're looking for in the article to change the language is to change the language from Swiss speech specific to all of the town of Wareham. And if you read the document there, 314, and just highlight the area where it says by December 31st, 2017, it talks about a complete analysis of INI and the town completed by that date. So we have money for engineering in the that article that you spoke of, $750,000. And we want to meet that requirement. So we're asking that the money be not specific to a speech, but for the entire town to give us the option. Second page is an example. I've got one quote. I've got two more coming. The second session, you'll see at the very end of that one from OSG engineering firm. his estimate to do that task would be, I believe it's $525,000. I've got one coming from GHD Engineering. I have one coming from Beta Engineering. So I'll have a better handle on the actual cost, but it's going to be $500,000, we're thinking. At least we have $525,000, so we know that. So the others can either be lower or higher. We'll make a decision based upon those when they come in. And then the final piece I included was an example of, as for the INI, is an example of what we've done. We had an engineer go out ahead of us, and what we're trying to accomplish is identify the hot spots, if you will, the areas where we have excessive INI. We broke our system down into, just so you understand, this is our pump stations, it's 45 of them, and we break them down into catchment areas. So each pump station has an area, the catchment area that it's responsible for. So we take the numbers from that pump station, we run the, you know, the pump run times and all those things, and we see how much the pump runs, we see how much it's supposed to run by the actual houses. And in the report you read, each house has a specific amount of gallons that should come out of it based upon the size. And so there's our pump stations, there's 45 of them, so we have to take, and sometimes we'll group three or four together, with the key ingredient being 20,000 linear feet. And by doing 20,000 linear feet, it'll give us a better sense of if we have INI because it's smaller. As an example, in Swiss Beach in general, we have two pump catchment areas. We have Ruggles and we have Smith. Smith is huge, many, many miles, probably 5 miles of pipe. Where in Ruggles is probably a mile of pipe, or less than that. So when you do the formula, the size of the pipe per inch by mile, it's an actual formula that DEP gives us to use. The longer the area, the less you're going to see excessive INI. The shorter the area, the more excessive INI you're going to see. So if you look at 214, CMR 214, 314 CMR 1204, that's why the DEP changed their direction and said to us that you must use 20,000 linear feet opposed to a longer area, because if I do a longer area, in theory, I could have no INI in Wareham. And so they're saying make it smaller so you can identify the INI. Mm-hmm. So that's part of the process. So that's why we'll break out the catchment areas for smaller areas to get the 20,000 linear feet. So that's why we're asking to move the money and use it for the entire town, so it becomes beneficial to the town.
So what you're planning on doing on Article 3 is you've done Swiss Beach, you've done the investigation and engineering in there, and there's still money left over.
$662,397, we expended, I think, $82,000 or $750, whatever the numbers come out to be.
All right, so you have extra money, you've identified other areas in the town that are, let's say, critical,
yes,
from an INI point of view. What you want to do is use the balance, this $662,000, to investigate those areas, engineer repairs for those areas.
Absolutely. Which essentially is the rest of the entire town. We've done six areas, and I gave an example of one, which is Pinehurst. Pinehurst has quite a bit of excessive INI because we have pipe on the beach. We have manholes under the beach, and there's a lot below sea level, and so it manifests a lot of INI. So we've identified that area. So what we'll do now is, once we identify the INI by data, then we send equipment in. We'll put the cameras in, and we'll see. And I think, Dave, you have the benefit of seeing some of the video we showed.
I did, yes.
And so we go in there, we see the condition of the pipe, we see the weepers, we see the leakers, we see all those type of things. And then we go and we can facilitate some type of repair. We write an IF invitation for bid, we give this to the contract, we give them all the pictures and videos we have, and they come back to us with a price and they're going to be able to do the job. So when we identify an area, and I've got some areas here, there's five specific, Pinehurst, Onset has Onset Heights, Southwater, North Boulevard, there's Hines Field. These areas have been identified as excessive. So that means we're getting too much INI. So we're going to go into those areas, we'll smoke them, we'll camera them, and then we'll make some decisions to what the repairs are going to be. Once we get done with those that we already identified, we're going to keep going because we've got the rest of the entire town, because of December 31, 2017, I have to submit to the DEP the entire town.
So what you're doing is you're prioritizing the town based upon inflows that you're measuring at the various manholes and pump stations, and once you go through that priority, you're going to continue until you get the entire town.
That's right, it's nonstop, absolutely, it's nonstop. And then not only do we have to identify, we have to write a plan as to how we're going to approach it and how we're going to solve it, and we write that to the
All right. So that
explains that. So, I mean, the letter, that's why I gave you the actual documentation of what the state is saying to us, what our requirements are.
Right, so from Article 3, when it was voted, it limited it to Swiss Beach area.
Yes, sir.
And what we're doing is we're expanding it to cover the entire town as long as the money lasts.
We'll expand
and starting with the high infiltration areas.
Yes, sir. And when it becomes a systematic approach to I&I, opposed to just saying Swiss Beach is in trouble, we'll fix every single pipe, because there are pipes that leak more than others. There are some that have, as we're finding, more structural damage than others. So you should usually hit the hot spots. Hotspot in Swiss Beach. We're now in Hamilton Beach. We're finding roots overtaking entire lines. We've got manholes totally engulfed by roots. We've got cracks. We've got fractures. We're in onset at 12th Street. We're finding entire clay pipes totally cracked, broken, bells, roots between every joint, roots up laterals. And so as we keep going, we keep finding these problems, and we've got to solve them. So it gives us direction. And because when you have, again, we have a bunch of roots in the pipe, obviously you're on the water table, water's coming in. It's also tidal. It can be effect to it. Rain can be effect to it. When we rain, we see anywhere from 100 to 300,000 gallons per day of infiltration, depending on the more rain we get, it gets overwhelming. So it's just giving us how we're going to focus our dollars, because let's face it, I could spend hundreds of millions of dollars on the problem, and we don't have hundreds of millions of dollars. I promise you, I don't have any money hit anywhere. I don't have it. But the point is that I have to do it. So we have to figure out where we're going to focus our money, which little we have. You know, we can probably spend $500,000 a year, and that's all. So where does that $500,000 go? And so we've got to be very specific and precise as where we're going to put that money. So that's why we'll utilize all that money. When it's gone, it's gone. We've got to figure out how to keep going. So that speaks to that.
You're using it for investigation. Yes. And remedy?
Yes, we're trying to do both. Oh, let me answer that. We'd like to do it for investigation more than remedy, because after we investigate, then we can prioritize remedy. For remedy, tomorrow morning I'm meeting engineers, we're going to apply for another grant for remedy. We're also going to budget so much money per year in the budget for remedy. And if it becomes not enough, then we'll have to figure it out. But the DEP is telling us that by December 31st, we have to have a total investigation. So we have funds available. I'll transfer those funds over and utilize it. And so I can answer the DEP by the end of December 2017 and say, yes, here's our report. And then we can facilitate repairs, move forward. So that it's more to your, Tom, good question. It's more to find out where we really are.
So Article 3 is to find out what the status of the town's sewer system is.
Absolutely.
And
You got to run into some things that are just horrendous, and you say you've got an emergency situation, you got a remedy, period, right?
That's
now.
Right. We're doing 1,600 feet in Swiss Beach because we found some pipes. I mean, the pipes are actually have inclinations like this. They have actually total, I can see rock, I can see sand, sand's coming in, sand is over on my pumps, the pump station. So yeah, so we say, okay, this becomes, it's not an emergency by emergency definition, but let me tell you, it's close to being an emergency. And as the sand is taken out of the ground from around those pipes, we've already had a collapse. So the roads are collapsed, and it can be quite dangerous. So we know that it's a priority. So we're going to line that. As much as we want the I&I, our biggest concern is structural. Because if we lose the integrity of that pipe, then everything around it, all the sand as that moves, it's going to drop. And plus, you get the water table coming up and down. It's a 6-foot water table. Pipes are 17 feet down. There's constant movement. So it becomes I&I, but as importantly, if not more importantly at this point, is structural. So that's why we're pushing to get Swiss Beach done immediately. One Kinko and Bayview. Of all the lines that we've investigated in the Ruggles catchment area, those are the two most critical that could become catastrophic if we ignore them. And so that's why we're pushing to get those two particular lights out.
Now, is it a remedy that you do today a heck of a lot different than you do 10 years ago?
10 years ago, we would have dug it up. And to give an example of the cost, I put some fields out there, called some contractors.
And today you would do what?
Line it. We'd go line manhole to manhole, which is going to cost us about $240,000 to do 1,600 feet. To replace, it cost me $140,000 to do 20 feet. So it's quite a difference. So years ago, you would have dug everything up, you would have dewatered, you would have shored the whole area down 17 feet. It would have been quite expensive. Just getting ready to replace the pipe.
But the remedy is a patch, or is the remedy a pretty soon?
The remedy is to line the 1,600 feet. Because you have a break and you go 20 feet, and you have another crack, you go 20 feet. Yep. It makes no sense to just go in there, because you can go in and just put a little Band-Aid here, a little Band-Aid there, but it makes sense to do the whole line, to bring that whole run of Wankinko back to structural. And once it's done, it becomes a structural repair. So that pipe is as good as new, and it's got a life expectancy back to 50 years. Okay. So that would be the best way to go about it. How much the sub 50 we spent? I wrote it down, but we got 692,397.61 left. Now, you asked about transferring the money out of retained into the budget to do the repair in Swiss Beach, and that's approximately $125 a foot, 1,600 feet, plus a 20% for contingency for unknowns. It's $240,000. And it will come out of retained earnings and go into the budget, is what we'll ask town meeting. Whatever they say is what we'll do. I think you asked a question about the $200,000 that I presently have in unforeseen emergencies. I'm not touching that. The year's not over, and it makes no sense to touch that, because if I utilize that, it's going to be $40,000 short, and I utilize it, and I have something come up after town meeting, I'm dead in the water. So it makes no sense to take money that I have in reserve, because we're not through the fiscal yet. If this was June 31st, I may have a different answer for you, but right now, it makes no sense to touch that money. So we're not going to touch the money. It makes more sense to go to retain.
So the repairs are not in Article 3, it's just the investigation?
Correct. The repairs are in Article 4.
The repairs are in Article 4. Got it.
Yes.
Transfer of funds.
Yep. Does anyone have any questions on Article 3? Being none, I'd like a motion to accept.
Motion to accept.
Or recommend approval. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right. 600. And transfer of funds. You're asking for $240,000 at this point.
Yes, sir.
And that's for the no repairs at Swift Beach.
Correct.
And you're maintaining your reserves in case you need them.
Yes, sir.
All right. Any questions on Article 4? That's right.
Move to approve.
We have a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. That's unanimous also.
Now, you also asked me about the sewer capitalization stabilization fund established a couple of years ago, at least maybe three, I'm not so sure. Mm-hmm. And that's a good question. I don't have an answer for you. What I would recommend is that we finance it by a percent of money from our retained earnings, and I don't know how we'll go about that, and I'll find out for you. I'll talk to town administrator and see the best approach, but we should create a stabilization fund for a rainy day, and you know, when it pours, it's nice to be able to put an umbrella up. So, but we don't know how to fund it. That was the question at the town meeting when we approved, because there's two articles, and so the fund was not passed, if I remember correctly. That's the question. So that's open to discussion. I'll discuss it with Sullivan, the board, but we have retained earnings. We put some money in there regularly each year, and money we're not using in the budget, plus some fees and penalties and things that we don't put into the budget. So I'm thinking a percent of that money each year should go into this capital stabilization fund for whatever. And so that's how we'll try to address that. So that's where we are with that.
Very good.
And so I think that answers all your questions, but I can be as specific as you would like me to be on anything, and I'd be more than happy to.
No, I appreciate it. Board, Joan, any questions?
No, I'm fine. Thank you.
Stuart?
No.
Ellis?
No, I guess I'm good.
No, nothing. Thank you. Very good presentation.
Very good, Guy, thank you very much.
My pleasure. My pleasure. This is the area so you'll have it. You're probably all familiar with these areas, but this is a catchment area.
Is this online?
You know, let me find out. It is online. I could, we have a website, and I've got every camera job. You can see the actual video, you can see the pictures, you can see the entire system, you can see the pump stations, you can see the manholes, you can see the condition of manholes, because we're out there inspecting them all the time, and the camera put them online. But let me find out. It's a website that we have, and I'll ask Mr. Sullivan and others if I can make it public. Maybe I can make it to you as a committee member, but I don't know if I can make it public. So
geez, I'd like to watch the poop come on.
There's a lot going on. You can just watch everything in that website, in the cloud. It's all there. You can see. So you can answer your own questions. If you want to know what we're doing, it's all there. So all this is the Ruggles catchment area. So you can see that's only a small area in the big whole entire Swiss beach. And so that's why we can see in Ruggles more excessive that we cannot see in the rest of Swiss Beach, which becomes Smith.
Is this what happens when you see the picture in the paper of the sinkhole of the,
just one of the reasons.
In Florida or in Oregon or wherever the heck?
Florida, I'm not so sure. They have very high water tables. They have a lot of stumps they did years ago, and I'm not so sure before. I can't speak to that. But yeah, there's a lot of sinkholes and a lot of sewer, water, other things that are moving. Can be a problem, yes.
It was transferred to the emergency fund, and then he pulls it from the emergency fund to fix it. This beach. Makes sense. I don't know if Connor can. Again.
What did you just ask for that? Did you know that?
Sure.
Article 4, you're asking for $240,000.
Correct.
And that's coming from?
Retained earnings.
Retained earnings. All right.
So your question was, why couldn't I take it from emergency funds? And my answer was, I don't want to take it from emergency funds because I still have the rest of the fiscal year to go. So we'll take it from retained earnings because we have the invitation for bid ready to go out.
I understand. Four says that we're taking money from retained earnings and put it into the emergency fund. Am I in the wrong spot?
We're taking it from retained earnings. We're not taking it from emergency funds, which is a line.
Right, that's what it says. We're taking from retained earnings and we're putting it into the emergency fund.
No, it should go.
We're putting it to the, that's just saying, to the budget for the purpose of emergency.
It's got to go in the annual budget, okay. Is where it should go to.
Yeah,
it's going into the annual budget.
That's what it says, purpose of an emergency. You're saying we're putting it in there, we're going to take it right out and put it in Swiss Beach.
It's
going to the budget specific Swiss Beach. We're going to move it from retained earnings, which takes an act of, you know, town meeting, it's a legislative act, right. And then we move it into the budget to be expended for Swiss Beach specific. That's all it's for.
The description in the article says for the purpose of emergency and unforeseen infrastructure repairs. Actually, at this point, we've identified where the repairs are.
We know exactly where it is. And originally,
that's the confusion.
Yeah, and I wouldn't call it emergency because it's by definition of emergency, but it is a high priority. I mean, it's not an emergency by definition, but it could be, and so we're calling it a high priority. So we already done
the whole Swiss Beach repairs, $240,000?
For
this area.
Just 1,600 feet, that's it.
Okay.
To do all
I just
want
to get it right for... Yes. For my write up,
yes, because to do all of Swiss Beach and to answer your question, there's pipes which I can show you the camera. There's pipes that we won't touch. There may be 3 years down the road we have to come back because we see some cracks, but they're not fractures yet. They're not exposing the sand or the gravel. So there's something we'll watch on an annual basis, and then we'll say, okay, now we repair them because we want to get the hot spots first, and we'll keep working the circle, getting the hot, because, and I don't want to lose sight of the fact that one of the main reasons is capacity. We need the capacity. We need the capacity.
Yeah. We have to establish a priority.
Absolutely.
Right. That's one of the advantages of using the lining technique, is that you can isolate areas between manholes and do area between two manholes and not go on. And you can identify the critical areas and work on the critical areas and come back later and do from that manhole. The manhole you stopped at to another manhole if you need to.
Absolutely. And there's another fact that, you know, I should point out is we're dealing with asbestos pipe. So if I cut it and take it out, the cost of remediation is expensive. You can no longer There was a time you could break it 17 feet in the ground, leave it. You're no longer allowed to break it because of leading into the water table. So you don't touch, if you're going to do asbestos, you've got to factor in getting rid of it. So by doing lining, that pipe is still intact, and so we're going to line it, and it becomes a new pipe without having to mitigate asbestos.
Is this the, I guess I saw an ad where they sort of push or blow in an inside out thing and that hardens or something?
Yes, sir. They actually blow it in. I've got a video. They blow it in. It's inverted. So they invert the line. It's impregnated with epoxy.
Yeah.
It could be different material. There's mesh materials, like fiberglass, what have you. And it goes in, and the epoxy, as they put this thing in, the 600 feet, they put air or water, depending on the technology, and it blows that liner up. And it forces it against the wall of that pipe, and the epoxy actually gets into the pipe, and they maintain that for so long for adhesion. And it's just once it's adhered, then they heat it for so long. Sometimes they use steam or infrared, whatever they use, and now that becomes solid. It's all with the polymer and molecular, and it becomes solid as a rock.
I've seen a video of it.
Solid,
it's amazing.
It's amazing. And the technology is being used in Canada quite extensively, Europe, because of the age, and you don't just dig up, and things go under buildings and highways and what have you, in Australia. So it's been perfected over Europe. True. I mean, they perfected it. And so it's slowly making its way here.
And you would say that's as good as digging it up and putting a brand new modern pipe in.
Absolutely.
Every bit as good.
Absolutely.
I'll tell them that.
Absolutely. And that's the beauty of it. And that's the beauty of it. You make a new pipe, and you're not doing the, because of the intrusion or the inconvenience or all the different things you got to cause when you dig up. The deep dig of a pipe is, my gosh, it's crazy. So this eliminates all of that. And so it's a savings to everybody.
What's the cost difference? Or cost?
Well, the cost difference is, it's not so much the pipe per foot, it's everything goes around the digging up of that pipe. And the shoring of that pipe, so that's, and I...
We heard $1,600 a foot for...
What you heard is $125 a foot to do, and I can do the math for you. I'm going to do 1,600 feet for $240,000. I replaced AC with PVC 20 feet, and it cost me $140,000. So that's 20 feet opposed to 1,600 feet, half the money. So you can do the math. It's quite expensive to deep dig, to go chase a pipe, plus get rid of it, because we had just that 20 feet had to be. So it was good. That cost just to get rid of that 20-foot piece of pipe was expensive.
And that wouldn't fix your
7,000 or foot.
It does. It'll take the deflection out. Yeah. When they put that in there and they bond it, it takes the deflection out.
Really?
It won't be perfect, but yes, it'll take that deflection right out. Absolutely. Wow. Absolutely.
So, Tom, your answer is $125 a foot versus $7,000 a foot.
The other thing is that if there's water in there, when they put this in, it forces the water out for adhesion.
Yeah.
So I don't have to go chase the water. That's a cost in itself. Plug it up, vacuum it out, clean it up, heat it up, and get the pipe. So this saves that type of money also. So, I mean, it's just so many benefits.
Right.
And it's the material is safe for drinking water. So we worry about bleeding into the water table. And all it's NSF certified, so there's a lot of advantages. So it's the way to go.
Pretty well established now, from what you're saying. It's not so new that 10 years from now we're going to find out.
It's been done forever. So the research has been out there. University of Virginia, University of Texas, University of St. Louis, Louisiana. It's extensive. The research is extensive, and they've wrote the ASME figures, the standards. I mean, there's a lot of work. And there's NAST, and there's NASCO, these companies, national companies, have done a lot of work. So everything's out there. It's good, clean, solid technology with proven track records.
Well, you mentioned that you do it over in Europe.
Absolutely.
And some of those pipes go back to Roman times.
Absolutely. They've been there forever. Because some of those pipes are buildings you can't even get at. You couldn't dig them if you chose to dig them. You just couldn't get at them. So they have to come up with some technology to make these repairs. And so they have. This is all European. Pretty interesting. Pretty interesting.
Very good.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you very much.
I didn't think sewers would be so thrilling.
Yeah, they're excited. Trust me, it's exciting.
All right. Very good. Our town administrator is here.
One more time.
Yes.
Okay. Oh, thanks. Oh, that's the new laws of driving and stuff.
Good evening.
Good evening. Thank you for taking the time and being here. We have a few articles that we'd like to finish up, if you can help us with. I know the Capital Planning Committee met today, and you may have something on the budget transfers.
The budget transfers, you probably wouldn't have anything until the end. We do have the budget that's going to be printed, which the school committee's voting on their number tonight. I can't tell you whether they're going to do it or not. I've asked for a text on there, but my understanding is, if I were a betting man...
No, we already have the numbers. They can't change anymore.
No. That's... The only thing they changed from there was just they moved some of the funds from the non-net up to the net, approximately $60,000. So the bottom line number doesn't change.
Yeah, we effectively vote on the bottom line.
Yeah.
They move it around the year anyway.
Yeah, we do vote the non-net and net separately, but I do like the leeway that they have with a big lump sum. I could have a lot of fun with that. So. Thank you. And I told you about the, if you go to page 4 of 4, you'll see the town insurance general liability, a almost $30,000 increase. We have approximately another $16,000 worth of credits from Maya that will be available next year. So we'll utilize those. Maya will be phasing those out. Most of their credits accrue, including prepayments. They had their fund was doing well enough at one point where they were going to have to give money back to either the government or members, so they chose the members, which I appreciate. But that's they're reaching the point where that's no longer possible. So the general liability should stay. We have a couple credits on there, and they're telling me that they'll stay right about the same. I still don't have the final rate, but I feel comfortable going toward it. With these, if worse comes to worse, I'll have to make a transfer between them at fall time.
This is on page 3.
Page 3 of 4. Excuse me.
3 of 4. You're trying to confuse us.
I am. Well, I gave. I made sure I took the copy where page 3 was stapled in the place of page 4. So no one would be confused.
All right.
I confuse myself.
All right. Budget then. Well, let's see, then the 2017 budget, which you have here before us, is $59,383,327.
Yeah, we'll have to, we'll write it out because when you're, that's sort of the total budget. When you look, Upper Cape Cod Tech is included in there, which is a separate article, and also state and county assessments and such. So when we vote it, we're really, we'll be voting it in a manner that sort of breaks those down to adhere with the DOR standards. So I think rather than voting the whole number, which potentially could...
cause some confusion.
I would say, as presented, Kelly will have this copy. This is what would be in the booklet as well. So you could even, maybe this is, I'll take great pleasure if this is Appendix A.
All right. Do we have any questions for Derek at this point? All right. May I have a motion?
Derek, you don't show the revenues from your ambulance receipts or anything, where are they showing them?
Yeah, since it's an offset receipt, that is all that you show for them. on that page. When you look at it, it'll show the wages and expenses, and that's the total offset receipts. We don't budget their revenue at all. You're just, they're a separate article as well, so you really only budget their expenses.
Oh, they have to transfer the money from somewhere.
Well, they just receive the funds, and if we were ever short, then that's the issue on that.
Oh.
So it's Article 9?
Yeah.
Is the EMS budget?
This is just sort of the omnibus budget, and when we do it for the town meeting vote, we shrink this down, take out the revolving funds, enterprise funds, things like that, to sort of simplify it.
All right. Ian, can I have a motion?
Motion to approve.
With a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? There being none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right. 600.
This makes an assumption we're trusting the administrator to spend it properly.
We have the budget, we just have to, it's going to be broken down, and it'll be a little bit different from this one, it's presented to town.
If you had that much trust, you'd just say, general government budget of 7 million.
No, no, no.
When you think about it, you can't move it around anyway.
You really can't, so it's...
You got to pay the gasoline, whether it's there or not.
All right. Was the capital plan finalized?
So on the annual town meeting, the only amounts we have for capital planning are one, the WPCF, what they brought forward to you, which is the $1,006,000. So we have to approve that under the capital plan as well. And then we have within the lines of the police capital, you'll see that there's approximately, it's out there, it's
800.
No, there should be 160 some odd thousand, of which 60,150 is prior year leases. The rest is our leases for 5 new vehicles. It's a 3-year lease. We do a capital lease, so that would be 5. I'm asking specifically for 5 vehicles because I'm looking for it. It's if I call it cruisers, we don't have the potential for the prisoner transport, and with the way that's going down south on us, we may have to make that a priority over one of the other cruisers. So when you look at it approximately for the, when you break it down, the purchase and outfitting of the 5 vehicles would roughly break down $57,407 over the 3 years, and that includes an estimated 3.5% interest rate. We don't get the 0% financing and 0.9 and 1.9.
So that's in your operating budget?
Yes, under the police.
So
we'll say as part of the budget, that's when they're approving the funding, but we still need the actual vehicles, the being allowed to purchase them. So that's why you have it in the capital.
I'm just trying to get my head about it. I marvel at the way you go through this. Sure.
So by our charter, we need to have the purchases approved, but we also need to do the funding as well. And when I have free cash, I'll usually do it in the same article. However, if we're doing it as part of the budget will be, when we vote upon the budget, that's the approval of the expenditure. However, you still need the approval, the separate approval of the actual purchase, and give them sort of a description of the vehicles and what you're going to do with them. So it's a little redundant, but...
That's what puzzled me, the redundancy.
Yeah. But that's the charter. So it's, and it's open, and it lets people know what we're doing with those funds. So,
oh, indeed, yeah.
Yeah.
Usually if you give them enough information, they don't ask questions.
The EMS, as we've already said, they're into the second year of their ambulance payments. That's why we don't need to have that approved anymore. They've already approved that ambulance. We purchased the first year with the Walmart funds. So that's, we really don't have that much. Where the other articles that are being done, like the MSBA and such, even though they're considered capital, they're rarely doing the purchasing and the approval already, so I wouldn't put in the capital plan again and confuse everyone, so.
So that's the school roof?
School roof and those items, they're obviously capital. Even the feasibility is considered capital, but it's, I don't want people to suddenly think that we're spending twice or.
Right. Pardon?
Reorganization.
Reorganization.
Only one. And that's going to Derek's finish. We can go through it.
This is the format for it.
So this is really the high level of the org chart. It's not breaking it down into every employee department and such. And I think this is what I want to present to town meeting rather than really going into depth of the org chart, because I think it just confused the heck out of everything. You know, what we're really doing is not just, if I were just creating the position of merging the community and economic development director and the planning director, both of them approximately $100,000 a year jobs. If we're just merging them, I wouldn't need any sort of town meeting approval. However, what we're trying to do is bring the departments together. They'll still be separate budgeted departments, but they will fall under the director of planning and community development. So it brings, although sometimes the interests aren't the same, if you heard between development and conservation and such, it does get everybody rowing in the same direction of creating the policies, of creating the practices, streamlining, so that everybody knows really where they stand. And the sort of the buzz catchphrase on here, or the standard would be, the creation of this department is to foster and acknowledge the interrelationship that is inherent in planning, community and economic development, zoning, conservation, community preservation, and inspectional services. This department will create and implement both short and long-term community goals. The department will help guide and coordinate efforts of the various boards, committees, and commissions so that the processes are streamlined to accomplish said goals. The department will have a great impact upon the community's development and will need to rely upon the technical skills of the staff, the use of policies and regulatory controls to achieve the community's desired development. That's trying to encompass everything in sort of one standard.
Well, why does this have to go to town meeting?
By the charter. The departmental reorganization needs approval by town meeting.
Okay.
I'm just going to answer the charter from now on. It seems to be a good answer, but it's it is tough, because when you think about it, we always say this is a business, but you only have two times a year really to make some of the changes and such, and you have to bring this forward. We had to do it when we created the finance director, and also after you can't implement this till after 60 days. After town meeting closes as well, so.
All right. Any questions on the reorganization? There being none, and you're planning on combining, there's no budget impact on this, there's no adverse budget impact, because the right now you have two, you have a planning director and you have a CETA director.
Correct.
In your budget.
We have both of these, and the CETA is paid through the CDBG grant. So when looking at it, you look at this position, and this is the you know, a high-end position, if you will. So I'm going to use the round number of $100,000 a year salary. However, there's also benefits involved. You can easily calculate 30%. So I would say you split it basically 50-50. However, on the salary, it looks out to be 65 from the CDBG grant, 65,000, and 35,000 from the town, and the town covers the benefits, such as health or all benefits, if you will, on that, which should be a sort of an equal compromise. We will be hiring a, as this progresses, and we have this person in, we will be changing some of the positions around, including hiring a more of a the technical planner, if you will, but also calling them a permit coordinator, which is the person that when we have the businesses coming in, where we've already done everything to establish that, they're actually coming to look at us and want to come to Wareham instead of, you know, losing that opportunity for them to even, they don't even look at you. That's, once we've got that all set up, you've got this technical planner who will literally lead them by the hand, the permit coordinator, and bring them, say, these are all the processes, and we have everything together. We've got a streamlined process, and we know that if we say this is what you need to do, this is what happens at the board and committee level as well. That's, you know, these are how we're going to get the development that we want in this community.
I think that's very important. I think it's important that we have a process when someone comes to town that we can go out and work with them within the guidelines that we have within the town, of course.
Right.
But that's a very lofty goal. Good.
Doesn't mean you throw everything right out the, we're not going to go for nuclear storage facilities or anything anytime soon.
We can use the one in Plymouth.
Yeah, exactly.
Would that pay a lot of tax money?
No, don't tell me.
I mean, if they're paying taxes, we could think about it. Yeah. We can't say no right away.
It looks like everything comes under an umbrella of commonality. And so they function together more cohesively and constructively.
And that's even the inspectional services, which are some of the signage, everything like that, and just trying to, as we make these changes, we're cleaning up some of the areas of the town as well. So it's I would love to say I'm the first, or we're the first developer of this, and we're thinking outside the box, but it's working in other communities, so we should adopt.
Good. Any other questions for Derek on this? There being none, I have a motion.
Motion to
Article 21.
Motion to approve.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Very good. So let's see. Got that. What else do we need?
A dog park. Have we done that?
Dog park was tabled.
Okay, motion to remove from the table, Article 23.
Article 23. Motion to remove. We have a second?
Second.
All right. Discussion. Let's open that up for discussion at this point. I think we've learned a few things since the petitioners were here. There are still problems on that.
I think we, in some way, have to constructively tell these people to keep working at it, but they do not have sufficient information to make us comfortable in terms of liability, ownership, and long-term management at this point in time.
And site.
And site, yes. Yeah, because if we build a school over there, we won't have room for the park.
That's a different location, but still.
Oh.
Right. We can use the same playground, is that it? Same parking area?
You could share. They could share as long as they pick up their two.
Don't think so.
The kids or the dogs, which
right.
They're probably easy to train.
All right. Any other thoughts on that? All right. Like motion?
for.
I'll make a motion to approve, or constructive motion on the floor. I'm trying to think of how we could pass on this without making a decision on it, leading these people at a disadvantage. I wouldn't want them to think we're not interested.
I've written up something that I think kind of does that, but.
Have you? In your creative writings skills?
Well, I try.
May I ask the moderator?
Any suggestions?
Any suggestions for how they should be worded?
You're talking about a motion?
Yes.
I mean, you could make a motion for a favorable action, but then you, if the majority is not in favor, it would be 060, and then in your explanation, say that, you know, here's the reason why it was voted negatively, or you could do further study.
Well, abstain.
Or abstain. Further study, unless you have a mechanism to further study it, actually kills the article in essence.
And we don't, not being the petitioners, we can't come up with a further study. Right. That's for them to come up with, and that's what we're hoping they will do.
Yeah. All we suggest in our vote would be just we abstain. And no.
And then write it up?
Mm-hmm.
All right. We have a motion to abstain. We have a second.
Well, we had a motion to approve. It was seconded.
All right.
So we just.
Why don't we vote the thing down? It isn't ready.
You could do a 050 or what would it be, a 060. Yeah.
What the heck?
It's not ready. All right, we had a motion to approve. Do we have a second?
Second.
I have a second? All right, all those in favor? All those opposed?
Well, I'm suggesting what he approved.
This is not approving it.
Not approving it, right.
Right.
Yeah, right.
Okay.
All right, so all those not approving? 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. All right, 060.
And but the write-up can include why we're not approving.
Yes.
Right, I've made recommendations in the write-up, and you guys can look at it, but that I've nicely said you're just not ready, you don't have the land, you don't have a plan for insurance. We don't want it. We recommend it's not town land. I don't want the DPW on the hook for cleaning up trash. I don't want the town on the hook for liability insurance. If I want to sell them land for a buck, I'd be happy with that. It's got to be theirs. Well, that's how I feel. It's got to be theirs. You own it. You do with it. Maybe there's a reversion on it. So if you, the whole thing folds up, the town gets the land back. But that would be all of the involvement.
All right.
And that also kills one of the CPC ones too, right?
That is a CPC item.
I also asked them to bring us, you know, I'm a tax guy. I never put big round numbers on the tax return. You know what I mean? And I just say, oh, $100,000. That would be no estimates, no. I'm suspicious. I just, you know, the work wasn't done. They don't have a plan. The ball fields are 24,000 to fence, and this is 100. Well, they got to stump and cut trees, but they have any estimates at all or anything. Just anything.
I'd like to see some.
Anything at all. Same with the church. I'd like to see some kind of, I'd like to see one of them here telling me what we need and some sort of written estimate, but that's already gone.
All right.
Well, we can reconsider if you would like.
I'm happy to leave it the way it is.
Stuart didn't have a chance to vote on the church.
Yeah, but he didn't hear their testimony either, so that wouldn't really be fair. Not that.
Well, the church didn't.
Right. In my opinion. Nope. We also have election of officers. And we had a town election. Do we normally approve that?
No.
And vote on that? We do not. All right. No vote required.
Did we vote on the enterprise fund?
This is the 24?
Yeah.
We did not. This is the Water Pollution Control Facility Enterprise Fund.
Motion to approve.
We have a second. This is Article 24 of the regular town meeting.
Second.
Any discussion? There being none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? 600. All right. So the only one we didn't vote on is the capital plan. Is that correct? For the regular spring town meeting?
Yeah, I believe so.
And the special, special?
It should just take, on there right now, what we're bringing forward is entering into allowing the treasurer collector to enter into compensating balances. And the other one is to expend the Title V septic loan interest. So they're usually under Article 1 of the annual town meeting under recurring business. And for whatever reason, when we formatted it, we left it off. So now we have a special special.
Uh-huh. All right.
And the that there's can't really vote on because there could be possibly citizens' participation articles or citizens' petition article, right? But for that, I think it's 100 signatures, so somebody's got to be running around like crazy.
All right, folks. So at the present time, we don't have the warrant for the special special?
No.
All right.
Closes tomorrow.
Closes tomorrow. So we will take no vote on that. All right. And let's see. The only other item was union contracts, which we have not voted on. Special.
We have
That's still under.
We have a couple executive sessions with the Board of Selectmen and such. So.
Okay.
These most likely would be, I don't know when you're, they could even be a night of or the week before a town meeting if you guys are having meetings. But it would be nice if we can resolve a few of them before the contracts actually expire. It's a big step for the town, considering I think last time we had to clean up some that were 6 years old and such. I realized at the end of this when we did essentially, there'll be 12 unions now, but we essentially did 11 one-year agreements, 11 three-year agreements, so you sort of work down there, and this could potentially, you'll have more three-year agreements if you do another 11 or 12. That's essentially 33 agreements in almost 4 years, which usually you wouldn't see over a decade or so. So,
wow. That's a lot of work.
Is there something magic about 3 years?
That's the maximum. That's what you usually do for those contracts.
You can't. You usually do. You could use four?
No.
So by what?
By Chapter 158, state law.
Only in the private sector can you do longer than three.
But I'll give you a 10-year contract, Tom.
To get us to.
And I'll extend that.
Was Article 12 Westfield going on the normal, the regular, or the special?
That will be going to the special.
Because they want the money faster.
Correct.
Okay, so we'll probably take the, do we need write-ups on both? I mean, it's the same
write-up.
Yeah.
Be the same write-up.
All right, if I can cut and paste it in. I was trying to save pages here.
Yep. All right.
The only other thing was, This is from the enterprise from the FY17 budget, so it won't match up. I wanted to give you just You probably actually have it from Guy, what I gave you tonight. And then I want to see for the Finance Committee the formatting for the revenue report on the enterprise fund, because if you look at it, and Guy mentioned it before, we're budgeting the user charge, the fees, and some of the betterments. You see where those monies are coming from. However, what is never seen is such as the sewer liens, penalties and interest, licenses and permits, fines and forfeitures, investment income, some of the miscellaneous, the tax title and foreclosures, and any transfers in from other funds. So it's, I think this is probably what you're looking for more, thank you, more comprehensive, rather than just the few lines.
Oh, this is good.
And we tried to tailor it to what we're doing for the revenue portion of the general government so that they sort of connect with one another. Now, obviously, the user charges, they're paid twice a year, so there's still some of the commitments outstanding. That's sort of the interesting thing when you have new members of the Finance Committee or some of these, they look at and they say, well, you're in deficit this month. You know, when you do the monthlies and they say, well, we only get our major portion of the revenue twice a year. So the day you start out, you're in a hole when it really happens. So that's a tough mindset to get over from when you're talking about running your own business and your financials and your run reports, if you will, versus what you're looking at from municipality and enterprise funds. But I don't think it
should be remedied.
Should be remedied?
Yeah, it should be monthly or weekly.
Really? Weekly charges?
No.
That's why sometimes I'm going to quarterly billing.
You should be able to get it down to
trying to eliminate the borrowing.
Certainly on a monthly basis, because you know you
should have put it on my Amex.
You want to bill monthly? You'd be billing monthly, like you'd bill people's taxes monthly then.
No, you just, it would reflect
dynamics too.
When the revenue is expected to hit. It isn't just 12 months, 1/12 every month in your budget. As I understand it now, you just take the annual amount and divide it by 12.
And then we give you a comparison to the previous year to date, so you have that to compare against. That's where you're seeing your comparison on that.
Never mind. See, the actual should be the actual, not some.
The actual, what you're seeing is the actual, and you.
The user charges for the budget.
That's what they've actually received for revenue.
That principal's not an expense.
For the one you give us every month.
Yeah, that's all the actuals.
With the way the budget is set up, you flow it out at in 1/12.
You're saying
you put 8% down every.
Okay. Right. So you put 8%. That's what your, especially with salary, that would be your comparison.
Salaries are easy.
Right.
Because they're more level.
When you're talking about
everything isn't necessarily level.
Correct. So.
But you know, the interesting.
I'm signing that 10-year contract right now, Tom.
Yeah. this born number is half of the original budget.
Correct. Born has not paid all their fees. They've requested additional information from the enterprise fund.
So, are we looking at a potential shortfall of $200,000?
Yeah, if that's not paid within the time, it would be a shortfall. But Bourne has always ended up paying us before the end of the fiscal year. We're working with them to try and remedy some of their concerns, and hopefully that will work out. No, they have as many police as we have, so we can't send guys with guns down there to get it out of them.
All right. Tax title and foreclosures.
Seems an unusual line item.
Yes. Why does the...
Or poop.
Why does the total... No, the total does even. Okay, I'm sorry. It is the same. Yes. So when you foreclose on a property...
That might have, you know, that has any past due accounts and such. You'll get the interest on there. They get the... to get whatever's due as well. If we have to auction the property to get it off, get it off of our books and get the revenues, you have the town, you have the district taxes, and you have sometimes sewer betterments or any of the back interest, and proportionally they'll get the money back. So.
Gets distributed.
Correct. All right. And if there's any... After all that's paid, including any of the attorney's fees, anything like that, then the balance would go to the general fund. But whenever you bring this in, the interesting thing that people don't understand is if we sold a house in foreclosure for $200,000, any of the revenues we get, all the revenues are deposited into the general fund, and that's by state law, and then they are dispersed to the other funds.
I think just
that makes sense.
The process you're using is tax title, but you're taking the sewer bills out of that same amount and all.
Right. So it's there's a lot of work that goes into recouping all those from the treasurer collector's office.
And just pushing numbers around, it's all day job.
So I appreciate what they do. They've been great on really going at it. And frankly, at the end of the day, we don't want to own anybody's property. We just want
them to pay their bills.
Yep, it's not cost effective.
It really isn't. It's the so we've made out well at some of these auctions. It's been great, but the you know, every time we take a property, it's almost $2,000 instant cost after everything else, even just for the insurance, the liability we have to put on it because we're the owners. So we've even had it where we took a property, and within a week, a rotten branch fell off a tree from there, and we got sued on it, so.
Got sued on it?
Oh. Some good luck there.
Home ownership.
Right. All right. Is there anything else in the town, for the town meeting, that we need to discuss with Derek?
The, special town meeting, as far as the capital goes. We did two things today at the capital planning. One was, and I don't know if we've gone over that, is the school would like to do the finish out their technology of the one-to-one program. In other words, bringing all the Chromebooks for their students and the related technologies. Usually, from our end of the business, from the municipal, I'd say, I'll wait till October town meeting. We'll have free cash, and you can get them then. Well, they reminded me their kids have to go to school a little earlier than that and get the whole system set up. So in speaking to them, I told them I don't believe we'll have really enough free cash to cover that, especially with the snow and ice deficit. You know, the last storm probably cost us another $30,000-$35,000. Looking at that, what I've spoken to them about is taking a one-time grant from the stabilization fund of $120,000, but yet we have to put it in the motion that at the fall town meeting, whatever our policy is, so half of the free cash going into the stabilization fund, let's say we had $1 million in stabilization, $500,000 supposed to go in, well, $620,000 is going to have to go back in. You can give yourself one-time grants out of it. You just have to be, I guess, stubborn's not the word, but you have to follow your own policies and put the money back in. So,
but that's what the money's there for, too.
It is. So this is it's a good use of it. Mm-hmm. It's not really for operating when it comes down to it, because you're replenishing it and such, and it's a capital item. You can basically borrow from it or give yourself one-time grants as long as you're putting it back in.
Was that the only capital on the special?
The one thing that was requested from capital planning as well, there was a strong push, was the animal control officer vehicle for $30,000. I asked them to basically put a, to approve it, capital planning, and then it's really working the numbers to see if we have it. I would bring that forward. I think it would, I think it's proper from this year's free cash, and let whatever the remainder balance of free cash is roll over. So it's a tough thing I'm asking you to vote for, because it's, I really think we can still do it and get the ACO vehicle, and we're looking at a Ford Transit that's outfitted for them, so it's probably, except for the additional equipment and some of the, you know, another air conditioning unit in the back, you'd probably be looking at a $23,000 vehicle all day, but it's a, the outfitting with everything, we're estimating at $30,000. So, the current vehicle she's in, I think everybody heard about, I think that it's over $300,000 with the, they're plugging in the leaks in there, and it's getting to be one of those vehicles that you don't really want to
want on the road. Okay.
And that's a driving job. That's a job that's driving all over the place. So,
yeah. Amazing how those miles add up, even when you're only going across town.
All right, and that would come from free cash.
That would come from free cash, $30,000.
Is there anything else on Article 6, special town meeting?
No.
Capital. All right, so we're talking, taking $120,000 from the stabilization fund for school technology. That money would be returned to the stabilization fund in the fall town meeting.
Through
free cash.
Certified free cash.
Yep. All right. And the second is a vehicle for the animal control officer and $30,000 from free cash to pay for that.
Correct.
All right. Do we have a motion on that?
So moved.
And a second.
Second.
Any discussion? Being none? All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? It is 600. Very good. And that's 00. All right. Anything else on town meeting?
What votes are still open? What votes are still open?
What do we have? We have budget transfers. We have, which we don't have yet.
Union contracts.
And union contracts. Yeah. And the special.
And
election of officers we're not voting on.
Capital plan.
Capital plan, Article 6. And
that's it.
Okay. Yep. All right. Anything else from the town administrator's point of view?
No, thank you.
All right.
You're a good job.
Good. I'd like to discuss our write-up in the town warrant. When we've gone favorable action, and in the past we have had, if it was rejected, it was listed as favorable action 060, which is confusing. And to avoid that confusion, for those that did not pass, I'd like to have it listed as unfavorable action. So if we're saying something is favorable, we're voting for it. If we've turned it down, we're saying it's unfavorable.
I think we discussed that earlier in...
Are you and Tropiano all set on that?
He's all set on that, yes.
It was more in the context of our explanation, though, kind of balanced it out or nullified the actual negativity of the unfavorable.
No, I'd rather put it down when we list the votes. It's been confusing in the past where you, even if you say favorable action 060, and then you explain why you didn't like it, it's much clearer if we can put it down as favorable action whatever it was, or unfavorable action. Just to avoid questions from the audience, from the people in town meeting. I think it clarifies things.
I would agree.
Wait, I don't understand what's wrong with for and against.
I think that's what I'm saying.
Huh?
I think that's what,
that's what we're saying.
Yeah.
But we didn't vote against.
But
we voted.
Favorable action.
Yes.
We're against it.
Next year we can do that.
Yeah, no,
I'm kind of neutral, but we don't like it anyway.
Huh? Right.
Just too many words. And
right. All right, does anybody have a problem with that wording?
No.
All right, good. All right. Any other items? This is the last day to vote on annual and special town meeting articles. So our schedule is Article 8 is the last day. End of this week really is the last time to get information by April 11th. We hope to get the warrant print. That's next week. And town meeting is April 25th. We are not going to hold a mock town meeting this year. We'll discuss that with the moderator. And that seems to be an acceptable item.
When do we get the report back from the printer? How far ahead of town meeting?
It doesn't come back very soon. Usually we get it back before the weekend. So we can get it ahead of time.
I'm just thinking it's a lot of information, and these people come in, they pick it up, they go in and take their seat, and they really don't have an opportunity. I mean, they're too busy socializing with everybody to actually read what we've said until it's called by the moderator.
Don't they have to get it 14 days before town meeting?
Excuse me?
Doesn't it have to come back from the printer 14 days before town meeting?
Is it 14 days?
Is it 14 days?
Can't be 14 days if it goes to print on the 11th.
No, right.
That's 14 days. So it's going to take a few days to get it printed.
It makes it 25.
I was thinking, Claire, is there any way of distributing it through the town that where the warrant's been posted, that there might be some copies available?
The Selectman's office usually has copies available the minute it comes back from the printer, so people can come in and pick it up.
All right.
Send some over to the library.
I mean, that's certainly up to you. It's very difficult to anticipate how many you're going to need, how many people are coming to town meetings, so you don't want to get too many out, and then people take it home, and then they don't come to town meeting with it, then you run short. So I think if they have to make the effort to come to the Board of Selectmen's office to pick it up, then it's somebody who's really interested in it and probably would be coming to town meeting. I mean, you know, it's up, the articles are up on the website.
So the articles have been up on the website. They've been posted in the newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
We've had television programs for meetings with the Selectmen and the Finance Committee. We've had virtually all the petitioners here. There have been blogs. The newspaper has done a good job of covering the articles. I understand what you're saying. It would be good if we could do that, and perhaps on the website in the future we could post the warrant with all the comments on it.
Yeah.
And that's something
that
we should look at in
that
the future.
Would be great.
That's something we should look at in the future.
Well, if Kelly has her version electronically, once she sends it to the printer, you could almost give it to Matt to put right up.
Let's see if we can do that. That's a good idea. We could post it up there. That would give people a little bit of advance time to look at it and make up their minds and understand what's going on.
Yeah, it's an awful lot of information to try and digest.
Right.
And we're spending almost $60 billion.
It's overwhelming when you just walk in and see it for the first time. It's like...
Right. Right. So I'm hoping people are watching at home and are taking notes or at least becoming interested in it. Have you any other thoughts that we should consider?
No. I'd like to commend you. I think you've done a wonderful job this year, you know, getting petitioners in, talking to department heads. I think you've comparing it to last year and the year before, you've got a lot more information. You've made it available through the television, you know, taping your meetings. So I just want to say I think you've done a great job.
Well, Claire, thank you. And also thank Wareham Public Television for publicizing this and putting it on TV. I think it's important that people understand how the town works, and this is an opportunity to participate in what is really the oldest form of democratic government that ever existed. Really, town meeting came over with the Pilgrims, and before that it was the tribal council where people got together and voted. It's a long history of...
Well, you know what Winston Churchill says about it. It's the worst form of government on the planet, but it's the best one we have.
But it's the best one we have. No, I think he said it the other way around.
No, he said it negatively. No,
that's what his point was.
Yeah.
It stinks, but it's...
There's nothing better.
Working with a democracy is the most difficult way to, because everybody has a point of view.
That's true. That's true. All right. Any other business? There being none, may we have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Very good. Thank you very much.
I'm for it.
Thank you.